this video we are going to talk about the Gram-Schmidt process. So what is the Gram-Schmidt process? Let's look at this process in a nutshell. So what the Gram-Schmidt process does is that in an inner product space, it takes any basis x1, x2, xn, and it produces, we use this process, the Gram-Schmidt process, and it produces an orthonormal basis v1, v2, vn. So let's recall before we start going ahead what is a basis. So a basis is a linearly independent set which is also spanning. So in other words, every element of your vector space, or in this case for an inner product space, can be written as a unique linear combination of these vectors x1, x2, xn. So this is true for any vector space, that we can produce a basis, and we have seen how to do that. But suppose now that you have an inner product space. So you have not only a vector space, but on that vector space you also have an inner product. Then you can use the Gram-Schmidt process to get from these x1, x2, xn, which is a basis, an orthonormal basis, which is, just to recall, that each of these vectors are mutually orthogonal. That means the inner product of vi and vj is 0 if I is not equal to j, and each of these vectors have norm 1. That means the inner product of vi with itself, so vi comma vi inner product, is 1. So that is an orthonormal basis, and in the previous videos we have seen why orthonormal bases are useful, because you can express various phenomena in very nice ways. In particular, you can write down the linear combination of any vector, the constants that appear in the linear combination, or the coefficients that appear in the linear combination, very nicely in terms of the inner product. And further, they represent something called the projection, which we saw in the previous video. So the projection can be written, or is the inner product of the given vector with some of these vectors, depending on where you want to project, and that is one of the, I mean, you have to divide by something and so on. So there was a formula that we found out last time, but that formula was particularly easy if you are, first of all, there is a formula if you have an inner product, if you are an orthonormal orthogonal basis. And if it is orthonormal, the formula is particularly easy, you do not even have to divide by anything. Okay, so even in this video we are going to use this idea of projection, and that is the main sort of key tool in the Gram-Schmidt process. Okay, so let us do an example and the intuition behind that, and study the intuition behind the Gram-Schmidt process. So let us look at this basis for R3, 1, 2, 2, minus 1, 0, 2 and 0, 0, 1. So first of all, you have to convince yourself that this is a basis. So recall that we know how to get basis for Rn by, if you are given n vectors, how to check if it is a basis. You just take those n vectors, put them into a matrix as the columns, or even it is okay even as rows, and you compute the determinant. So if the determinant is non-zero, then it will be a basis, and you can check that indeed this is a basis. So I leave that checking to you. So the question is, can we use this to obtain an orthonormal basis for R3? Okay, so now we want to convert from this basis to another basis which is an orthonormal basis. Now, as we have mentioned earlier in the convention here is that if no inner product is specifically mentioned, then that means you are looking at the standard inner product, the dot product in R3. So this is an orthonormal basis with respect to the dot product. So that is what we want to obtain, an orthonormal basis with respect to the dot product. Okay, so we start by taking 1, 2, 2. Well, we want to get something, so let us start with the first vector. Now, we want a vector which is orthogonal to v1. So let us first try to get an orthogonal basis. Yeah, so that means we want to get v1, v2, v3 so that they are mutually orthogonal. Then once we have an orthogonal basis, we know how to go from there to orthonormal by dividing by each vector by its norm. Okay, so let v1 be 1, 2, 2. We want a vector which is orthogonal to v1. So last time we saw that vectors which are orthogonal to v1 are exactly those which are in what we call v1 perp, or in general, if you have a vector subspace W, then vectors which are orthogonal to all vectors in W are exactly that set which is happens to be a subspace, is exactly the set or the subspace W perp. So, we want a vector which is in a V1 perp or span of V1 perp. So, we use the projection PV1 to V1. How do we use this? Well, here is how we use it. Define V2 to be, you take the second basis vector -1, 0, 2. So, you take this vector -1, 0, 2 and you subtract the projection of -1, 0, 2 onto V1 from -1, 0, 2. Okay, that is what you do. And then this is a standard computation which is something we have done in the previous video, namely P1 of -1, 0, 2 is it is some scalar multiple of V1. And what is that scalar multiple? It is the inner product of -1, 0, 2 with 1 to 2 divided by the norm square of 1 to 2. So, if you compute this, you get the numerator is -1 plus 4, so 3, and the denominator is 1 plus 4 plus 4, so 9. So, 3 by 9 is 1 by 3. So, I get -1, 0, 2 minus 1 by 3 times 1 to 2, and then if you do the subtraction, this is what you get, -4/3, -2/3, 4/3. Okay, so first of all, why did we do this? So, this was because remember last time that we saw that W perp. So, if you have any subspace W, then you have this other subspace called W perp, which is all those vectors V such that V comma, well, let me write this carefully, V such that inner product of V and W is 0 for all W in W, right? It was this set, and then we saw it is a subspace because we saw that this is the null space of PW. Okay, so what are we doing here? To obtain something W perp, what we should do is we should get something so that when we evaluate PW on that, then it gives us 0. So, PW of V equals 0 if and only if V belongs to W perp. This was what we saw. And the point is, if you look at the identity minus PW, so this is you evaluate this on V, if you evaluate this on V, so you get V minus PW of V. And if you again take PW of this, so now you have already projected, after you apply PW, you already projected into W. So, remember that PW, compose PW was just PW because the projection does not change elements in W, and that gives us that this is 0. This was something that we studied, which means that if you take an element of this form over here, this is inside W perp. So, this is what we have seen, and that is exactly what we are using here. We are using that if you do -1, 0, 2 minus PV1 of -1, 0, 2. So, you can rewrite this as 1 minus PV1, sorry, identity minus PV1 of -1, 0, 2, and this vector will be in V1 perp. This is what the idea is for this computation, and that is why we do this computation. We get V2. And this explanation below is a general method to see that V2 is in V1 perp, but you can actually explicitly do this by taking this vector V2 and computing V2 comma V1. I will encourage you to check that this is actually 0. Okay, so let us move on. So, now we have V1 and V2 which are orthogonal to each other. So, now we want a vector which is orthogonal to both V1 and V2. Because we want to, remember, we want to get an orthogonal basis. So, in other words, we want this vector, let us call it V3, to be in the span of V1, V2 perp. Okay, that is what we want. And how do we do this? Well, we again use the projection, and this is exactly the idea that we had in the previous slide. you take this span of v1 comma v2 as w, and you apply 1 minus i minus p w on some vector. Okay, you apply this on some vector, and then you are going to get a vector which is perpendicular to v1 and v2. The only thing is, you have to be careful that this vector that you have should not be already in the span of v1 v2, and that is where this basis comes in. Okay. So, the third vector is not in the span of v1 v2. How do I know that? Because the span of v1 v2 is the same as the span of the previous vectors that we had, right? Because you see, this 1 2 2 is just v1, and minus 1 0 2 and v1, the span is the same as the span of v1 and v2. Okay, so that is another thing you should check, because they are linear combinations of each other. So, we know that v3, or the third basis vector, is not in the span of v1 v2, and that is how we are going to use it. Okay. So, define v3 to be 0 0 1 minus pv1 of 0 0 1 minus pv2 of 0 0 1. Now, pw of 0 0 1 is exactly pv1 of 0 0 1 plus pv2 of 0 0 1. This is something we saw in the previous video. And now, you can evaluate this. I will encourage you to do that. It is a little bit of a computation, and if you do it correctly, and I hope I have done it correctly, then I have got 2 by 9 comma minus 2 by 9 comma 1 by 9. I will encourage you to check that. And the point is, this is a orthogonal basis. This is an orthogonal basis, and I do not even need to check this, because of what I did in the previous slide. I gave you the general theory for how to do this. So, this is an orthogonal basis. Now, if you have not understood why it is an orthogonal basis, I will encourage you again to check that this is an orthogonal basis. So, check that v1 v2 is v1 v3 is v2 v3 is 0. Okay, if you have not completely followed what I said in the previous slide. Okay, so in that case, you will get that v1 v2 v3 is an orthogonal basis, and now you divide each vector by its norm. I will encourage you to check what is the norm, and then if you do that, you get the orthonormal basis 1/3 2/3 2/3, minus 2/3 minus 1/3 2/3, and 2/3 minus 2/3 1/3. You may remember this basis from a previous video. Okay, so now let's do the Gram-Schmidt process. The intuition we have seen already. You start with a basis, and then you keep modifying the vectors in that basis so as to get an orthogonal basis, and further you will be dividing by the norm so as to make it orthonormal. Now, the Gram-Schmidt process kind of takes this orthogonal basis and divides by the norm in one shot, meaning it does not wait till the end to divide. It starts dividing right from the start. The reason being, it helps for efficiency, computational efficiency. Okay, so let's start with the basis x1, x2, xn, and define the orthogonal v1 v2 vn, and the corresponding orthonormal basis w1, w2, wn as follows. So, v1 is x1, w1 is v1 by norm of v1. This is what we saw in the previous example. v2 is x2 minus x2 comma w1 inner product times w1. So, now why didn't I, in the previous slides, previous example, I took v2 x2 minus x2 comma v1 inner product, and then divided by norm of v1 comma v1 into v1. So, the thing is, if you already convert your basis vectors into the orthonormal form, then you need not divide by their norm, because you know that the norm is 1, and this is what I meant by saying that there is some computational efficiency. So, you do not have to keep dividing by its norm. Okay, and then w2 is v2 by norm of v2. So, you have v1 and v2 is an orthogonal basis which span the same as x1, x2, and w1 and w2 is an orthonormal basis with span, sorry, should be careful, it is not a basis. So, I take back the word basis. These are linearly independent vectors, but which are orthogonal, and w1 and w2 are orthonormal vectors. So, they are automatically linearly independent. So, you keep going. What is the general term? So, the ith term will be given as, suppose you have reached I minus 1th stage, you have v I minus 1 and w I minus 1, all the vectors still there. So, v I is x I minus inner product of x I comma w 1 times w 1 minus inner product of x I comma w 2 times w 2 minus all the way up to inner product of x I comma w I minus 1 times w I minus 1. And then w I is you normalize this vector, which means you take v I and divide by its norm. And you keep going till the end, and in v n you have all the previous vectors defined till n minus 1, and then v n is x n minus inner product x n comma w 1 times w 1 minus inner product x n comma w 2 times w 2 all the way up to inner product x n comma w n minus 1 times w n minus 1, and then w n is v n by norm of v n. So, now the main point here is that if you take this basis w 1 w 2 w n, it is an orthonormal basis, v 1 v 2 v n is an orthogonal basis. And the reason this works, this is the main point, is that span of the set x 1 x 2 x I minus 1 is equal to the span of the set v 1 v 2 v I minus 1, and which is again equal to the span of the set w 1 w 2 w I minus 1. And because these spans are the same, we know that x I does not belong to this span, and we can carry out this process. This is what I explained in the previous example, and this is the main point. Okay. So, the main take homes in this, maybe before I come here, I will point out also that this part here, so this thing here is exactly equal to P span of W 1 through W I minus 1 of x I. Yeah, this is the projection of x I onto the subspace spanned by W 1 W 2 W I minus 1, and this comment up here tells you that this is as a result the same as the projection of x I on the span of x 1 x 2 x I minus 1. So, really this entire thing is about projecting carefully, and as we know projections give you things which are orthonormal, I mean orthogonal. This was the main point of the previous video or the projections video. Okay. So, with that brief comment, I will go to the next and final slide, which is what are the main take homes of this entire video. So, the main take homes are that if you take any finite dimensional vector space with an inner product, so in other words a finite dimensional inner product space, then it has an orthonormal basis. This was not something obvious from the previous videos that you can always get an orthonormal basis, but now not only can we get an orthonormal basis, we in fact have a explicit process. So, any basis can be changed to an orthonormal basis using the Gram-Schmidt process. So, how do you get an orthonormal basis? You start with any basis. So, the assumption here is that you can get a basis, and indeed we have seen in previous videos how to get a basis. And when I say previous videos, this is a few, maybe a week or so back or even before that. And then now, once you get a basis, you can change it to an orthonormal basis by using this Gram-Schmidt process. So, the idea often is that when you are doing using this kind of mathematics, typically you happen to know a basis. Yeah, you will somehow be able to construct some basis, and then it is some algorithm, namely the Gram-Schmidt process, that will allow you to actually get an orthonormal basis. And once you get an orthonormal basis, expressing any vector in terms of this orthogonal basis becomes very easy. That's what we have seen in the previous videos. Okay, so with this, I guess I'll end this video. Thank you.